I bet you he's loaded.
They're just selling.
Okay.
I don't know if they're certified for any services.
Who needs these directions anyway?
How are you, boy?
It was good. Really good.
At least some prices for cheaper price.
I guess the only one that's I feel good. I'm the oldest girl. Only David Bowling is older.
Right.
We started to get back home.
First of all, the show during rehearsal, I'm going to show this to my first group. It's
7:30.
I'll say something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I love it.
It was
just
dancing. Yeah, we used to.
I see this occurring.
When he's doing his rocky thing, he's giving me notes. I rock with him. it's joy.
It was the Arizona play. And the 24 hours is just the one play, right?
Yeah, I have a 2 week break. So we're going to go camping.
That it all lives together.
That's kind of what I do. I just kind of go like, kind of deduce from this situation. Should I stay and fix the cameras or go and fix my laptop? Tape on the top of the panel. Yeah.
Cooking up fire and
whatnot. Two more cameras.
Yeah.
I thought I was just going to grab them, the two and just go, okay, this one works, this one doesn't. So let's not mess with the one each other.
I had a friend
who was
Like Oh. So are you kind of directing the area, or are you kind of the director, you're the writer?
And where's your cowboy hat?
It must be a different play.
Yeah, he needs a beret for this one.
Exactly. No,
a different hat for everybody.
just shooting Nancy Repos.
That one, like Scott, 71, Marc looks at the audience searching. Adeline, chest. That's something you do?
Sure. Okay. So don't worry about those. Don't worry about the Nancy.
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Okay.
So Pasha, I leave. Do you have anything you want to ask me till we pass?
I think the usual questions are good.
I tailor it to what I feel too. So.
Yeah, go off what you feel.
You're about to sell me.
The language that I wonder about.
Different
languages.
So you want to see, maybe,
what
the response is.
And definitely, the character doesn't feel better than me.
I can tell you now. What character is it named?
Very funny.
I am dot dot dot.
I am
question.
Benko.
Okay, cool. I'll be right here.
My bag. There's a. Never mind. Okay.
Tonight when I pass the thing down,
we have this.
I can actually use.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Our associate artistic director asked me to tell you.
Lordy.
Don't be strangers if you guys want to come on down a bit closer, because I guess the associate artistic director is afraid of having to overproject for.
Aren't they actors?
Right?
I think Van Gogh has southern accent.
He's from southern France.
Use your diaphragm, Robbie.
Don't live in southern France.
But I took it.
It's on my
nightstand.
Does everyone. Scooting away from you now.
Great.
He had his cowboy hat on.
That should go stay behind him. Am I starting this?
I don't know.
I don't think so.
Do you want me to do the welcoming?
Did you? I care.
I don't care.
Yeah, you don't mind. Okay.
What's
the time?
Sure. Three minutes.
Okay, 3 minutes. 3 minutes, showtime.
Thank you, three.
Thank you, Art.
Oh.
You can get there early.
That's why he's always there early.
You do it.
Now we play
the waiting game.
Hi everyone. places. Welcome to the second draft reading of Pasha Yamotahari's I Am Van Gogh. This will start at 2. This will probably run close to the 5 o'clock, including talkback, to the 5 o'clock performance. You will have time to get to whatever you're going to. But smugglers will probably, the doors will open late, or if you're sitting here, you'll just come up. So just to give you that heads up, we won't start a play until you're where you need to be, at the 5 o'clock reading. So today, we are your actors, and let's go down and introduce ourselves.
My name is Paul Duran. I'm playing actor number 3.
I'm Heather Brady. I'm actor number 4.
I'm Scott McCary. I'm actor number 1.
I'm Robbie Harper. I'm actor number 2.
I'm Cody Goulder. I'm stage directions.
Is everybody ready?
There's an intermission.
There is an intermission.
And this play is called...
And this play is called I Am Van Gogh by Pasha Yamotahari.
Okay,
go ahead.
I Am Van Gogh by Pasha Yamotahari.
Getting back at you for that little comment.
Who wrote this? Act 1, Scene 1. A museum. Many of Van Gogh's paintings come to life on the numerous canvases that hang on stage. Marguerite Hoop enters with her husband, Theo Hoop, with enough space between them for a small boy, us. Marguerite kneels, and while looking down at the small boy...
This is your surprise.
We don't have much time, Margie. We have to get back to the train.
Theo, please be patient. What is it? Well, this is a museum, honey. Inside there are wonderful things for you to see and love.
I don't have the time.
I don't need you to have time. I need time with him, Theo.
These useless things are keeping you, me and him, from God's will. You're wasting his time like you did with...
The best way for him to know God... is to know love and appreciate many things, just like his brother did.
Theo exits after a heated look at his wife.
Go ahead, sweetie. Don't be afraid. Go wander around.
Marguerite walks around stage, eventually freezing in a tableau, leaving us alone. One of the panels brings up Van Gogh's painting of the Hospital Garden in Arles, 1889. The painting of the Hospital Garden in Arles, 1889, comes to life, eventually leading us to Vincent's bedroom in Arles, 1888. Van Gogh enters, kneels, and stares at us.
You're smaller than I thought you'd be. I was quite small, too, at your age. Don't be scared. You're not lost. In fact, you're found. You don't know who I am, but neither did they. But you will. I will be with you for the rest of your life. I'm here to make you understand that my energy is alive inside of you. That in spite of everything, we shall rise again. That you shall take up my pencil, my brush, which I forsake in my great discouragement, and you will go on with my... our drawings. That you will rise again. You are me, Marc-Andre. You are Vincent Van Gogh.
Marc, sweetie. Marc, what's wrong? Marc?
Van Gogh exits. Marguerite reappears, kneeling down.
Are you all right, honey? Are you sure? Good. You scared me. I thought maybe... Never mind, sweetie. Did you like this painting? You did? You want to be a painter? Like Van Gogh? I'm surprised you knew his name. Well, that's wonderful, sweetheart. I'll tell you a secret. Van Gogh's my favorite.
They exit. Scene 2. An elementary school classroom. A school desk and chair come to center. A teacher, Mr. Vassal, walks through invisible alleys made by the chairs taking in each drawing. Mr. Vassal eventually reaches the desk and looks down. He giggles and fights not breaking into a laugh.
Very good, Marc. Very good. Very interesting. Oh, nothing, Marc. Oh, yes, I do know that you'll be a painter one day. Yes, you've told everyone in the class this several times this school year. That's great, Marc. That's great.
A bell rings.
Oh, that's our time for today. Have a great night, kids. Marc, if you don't mind, I'd like to walk you outside to the pickup area. I just want to have a quick chat with your mom, okay?
Pickup area of the school. Marguerite enters holding a bag from a store as Mr. Vassal and us walk toward her. Before Mr. Vassal gets to Marguerite, she kneels, giving us a great big hug.
Mrs. Hoop? Mrs. Hoop, hello, how are you?
Hello, Mr. Vassal. I'm fine, thank you. And yourself?
Great. I was wondering if I could speak with you privately for a moment.
Is there something the matter? Marc, go play with the rest of the kids for a second, okay, sweetie?
This will only take a moment, Mrs. Hoop. Yes, well, I'm concerned about Marc, and how should I put this? Well, Marc is a very lovely and confident young boy, especially about his pictures and drawings. I encourage all the kids in the class to put their art on our wall of frames. But I'm a little concerned about Marc's pictures.
I very much enjoy my son's art.
Oh, as do I, really. Enjoy them as well. However, Marc is confident about his pictures. He expresses that confidence to the other kids and tells them how he will be an artist one day, which is great, don't get me wrong, but the kids are starting to bully him, mock him, and Yes, you see, that's why I have to send Marc's pictures home with him. I've tried to put his pictures, lovely pictures, up on the wall of a classroom wall, but the kids, Mrs. Hoop, the kids, they laugh.
I don't care what the kids say.
Oh, come on, Mrs. Hoop. Surely you must see that he doesn't have any talent in this form. We must be realistic here. It is important to get kids, especially at Marc's age, to not try to follow impossible...
I see very well, Mr. Vassal. Thank you for your advice, but Marc will be whoever Marc wants to be, and neither you or me or anyone else will keep him from that.
Mrs. Hoop, please understand...
That will be enough from you.
Mr. Vassal shakes his head and exits. Marguerite walks to us, kneeling down and wrapping us in her arms.
Everything's fine, honey. But you listen to me, okay? Good. You keep your love of nature, of life, of everything that you find beautiful, Marc. For that is the only way to understand art, to understand life, to understand you more and more. No matter what anyone thinks of what you love, you keep loving it. God gives us these so that we can see the life that we want, the way that we want, and only God can see that life with us. Don't let anyone make you see life differently. Promise?
She pulls out of the bag a large book.
I want you to have this, sweetheart. Open it. Yes, it is a book of Van Gogh's paintings. I'm glad you love it. I love you.
Scene 3, 6 years later. A high school art class. A few easels and studio chairs. Marc-Andre Hoop enters with school bag and sits at center easel next to another student, Armand, brushing at an imaginary canvas. Marc starts working on his canvas. After a little while, Mrs. DeBock, an eclectic art teacher, enters and walks slowly around the class, breathing in each student's work.
Focus, ladies and gentlemen, and find the structure of the vase. Its lines, its colors, and its life.
She walks up behind Armand's canvas.
Not bad. Not good. not anything. The lack of heart and desire leads to unenviable work. You must trust what lives inside you.
I'm trying.
Try harder.
She continues her sinister stroll, eventually locking on Mark's work. She delivers a quick snort, another, and yet another. She smiles and shakes her head.
If I can have everyone's attention for a second, please be so kind as to gather around to witness Mr. Hoop's piece here. We have here an example of unfocused, untrained, unenviable, and unimaginative work. Mr. Hoop, are you concentrating on the task at hand, or are your thoughts fluttering about?
I'm working very hard on this, Mrs. DeBock, trusting what's inside me, as you have told us.
Really? And what's inside you, Mr. Hoop? Is the word man in French, Mr. Hoop. It is not an answer to the question I asked you. To speak without conviction is to act without conviction, is to draw and paint without conviction. Students, I realize you are only freshmen at this school and would prefer to spend your time texting and tweeting, but I don't know how many times...
I feel there is a power within me, and I do what I can to bring it out. I work hard, Mrs. DeBock, and soon I will have more power over my brush, and when that happens, I will work still harder than I do now.
Interesting, Mr. Hoop. But the power with which you are attacking
I'm
me
not
and...
attacking?
You are attacking. And I want you and your lovely rising voice in the office after class so we can discuss the importance of truth in this class, this school, and our society.
I am telling the truth. I'm answering your question.
Enough! You talentless punk, how dare you?
How dare you? I am the future of art. You don't understand. None of you do. I am Van Gogh!
Marc-Andre snaps out of his rage and grabs his backpack, fleeing from the classroom. To the hallway, Mark, still in flux, kneels and searches through his backpack. Fighting his angst, he pulls out his Van Gogh book and flips through the pages until he finds The Vestibule of St. Paul's Hospital, 1889. The page comes to life on the screens.
I need you. Please. Please, I need to know that I'm not drawing to annoy people, but to make them see things worth observing and which not everybody knows.
He flips one more page and comes upon The Passage at St. Paul's Hospital, 1889.
I have great plans for our future.
Mark rises and turns and walks the passage. Eventually, he finds himself staring out the window of studio at St. Paul Hospital, 1889.
Hello?
Van Gogh enters and walks up to Mark.
Hello, Mark. I'm so glad to see you. How are you?
I'm lost.
Where have you been?
Here,
with you. This whole time I've watched you, I've studied.
My failures? I can't be who you want me to be. I'm not good. I'm sorry.
But you are who I want you to be, Mark. What would life be if we had no courage to attempt anything? Your journey, your destiny, will be one filled with the feeling of being poor, but you will be a painter. Trust me, Mark. The time will come when people will recognize that you are worth more than the value of the paints you use in your pictures.
But every single person has laughed and mocked me, and everything I've put to paper, to sketch, to canvas. How much longer till they know of my destiny, the one you promised me? What if I don't want this? Huh? What if you made a mistake, and I'm nothing? Nothing?
Mark, as we advance in life, it becomes more and more difficult. But in fighting the difficulties, the inmost strength of the heart is developed. Like that same scintillating strength that powered you against your teacher just now. Indeed, life is a have to defend and protect ourselves, but with a cheerful and brave spirit, we must battle. Do you understand?
I'm trying to be cheerful. I draw as much happy stuff as I can.
It's not what you draw that makes you cheerful. It's why you draw.
I draw for you.
You need to draw for you, Mark.
I just want to matter.
But you do matter, Mark. You matter most. By working hard, my boy, you will make something great one day. You haven't yet. Trust me, you haven't yet. But you must continue pursuing and fighting for it. Your teachers, your fellow painters and colleagues and friends, they mean nothing. They never will. You only need me. And the time has come for me to be more alive in your brush, in your slices and dabs, in every colorful breath you exhale on the canvas.
I was simply waiting, Marc.
For what? I was waiting for you to realize that you cannot do this on your own. You never could, and you never will. Do you understand?
You will be here for me from now on? You promise? You haven't before, and...
I am now. Now and forever, till your last breath. It is God's will, Marc. God's will. And mine. My son.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to doubt us. I just...
Doubts help us reiterate our desires, our ambitions. Find your cheerful spirit.
Cheerful. Okay. How's this?
Not bad. Try this. Good. I must go. We will see each other soon.
Don't leave yet, please.
Hey there, Van Cock. I am Van Cock, little painter. I am Van Suck.
Marc turns to see shadows where the voices are streaming from, and as he turns back around to Van Gogh, he's disappeared. The screen's empty, the Van Gogh paintings. Eventually, he returns to kneeling by his bag in the school hallway.
Mr. Van Gogh? Van Gogh! You will see. All of you, I am Van Gogh!
Scene 4, 3 years later. A college dorm room. Two doors, two desks, two chairs. A bunk bed and a window. On the lower bunk bed, a large suitcase, an easel, and several finished canvases rest. One of the doors in the room is closed. Marguerite enters and takes in the room, eventually peeking out the window. She breathes the possibilities of this environment, smiles. Marc Andre enters a few moments later with a suitcase, school bag, easel, and canvas.
Well, I guess this is it.
It's nice. This will be good for you, Marc. You have a lovely view of the river.
Yeah, I'm excited, Mom.
I do wish you weren't so far from us.
I know, Mom. I tried. It's not like there were any schools closer to home that wanted me.
Well, it's their loss, Marc.
If it wasn't for Father pulling strings, I'm sure I wouldn't have made it in here either.
I know that, Marc, and you know I won't pretend that he didn't, but this is an excellent school. You must take advantage of it.
I know, Mom. It just would have been nice to have gotten accepted here without...
I know, Marc, but God has a plan for all of us. There's a reason for everything.
Yeah, like a reason he didn't even come to walk me around his campus or show me around the cool hangouts of his alma mater.
Yes, there's a reason for that too, Marc. And your father may not want this future that you want, but his love for you, however, shadowed by his hesitance towards your choice, is still a love that lives in him. Trust me.
Yeah. It's a reason for everything.
Now, you know I want you to make sure you can tell
me. I will, Mommy.
And if you need anything at all,
I know, Mommy.
Don't you let
I won't, Mommy.
Any.
I won't, Mommy.
Like music it is.
What is?
Mommy. The way you say, Mommy.
Marc goes to his mother and hugs her. The fight of tears begins. A dashing young man, Georgie Gunagoo, opens the bathroom door, revealing a sink and mirror. He has an old-fashioned straight razor in his hand. He finishes shaving and watches for a moment.
Hello. This is a beautiful sight. Would love to sketch this.
Marc and his mother break, compose themselves.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt the moment. A great moment. Didn't mean to do that.
It's quite all right. I'm Marguerite Hoop, and this is my son, Marc Andre. Marc.
Georgie Gunagoo.
Hello.
Beautiful name. Marguerite, that is. From the Greek for pearl, yes? And the French Daisy? Beautiful name for a beautiful woman.
Thank you, but no thank you.
Right. And Marc, Andre Marc, is it? A little repetitive, but there's some musicality to the name.
It's just Marc. Hi.
Cool. Well, looks like we're bunk mates. Can mates. Mates. Should be an adventure, right?
Yeah. Yes.
George.
Georgie, like G whiz?
Yes, of course. Georgie. It was a pleasure to meet you. I will leave the two of you to get to know each other better. Marc?
Yes, Mommy. Mom. Mother.
I'm going to head back to the hotel. I'll drop by and see you tomorrow before I fly out, okay?
Yes, Mother, of course.
Love you, honey. Take care, Georgie.
Yes. Thank you, Mrs. Hu.
Marc walks Marguerite off stage and kisses her on the cheek before her exit. He gingerly walks back into the room.
So what? So your mom, she's cool, really hot. like, you know, pretty. I don't mean that, you know, I'm interested in her because I'm not. I'm just saying you come from good genes. Healthy and, you know, like good ones. So
what?
Wow, are you like antisocial or something? Do you speak?
Yeah, I speak. I've got lots of things I speak about.
Like what? You're like a regular Socrates, huh? Can't shut you up.
I know who that is, you know.
Who?
Socrates.
Good, that's great. Fantastic. Hey, I know. This is college, man. You and I, we're going to be in this room together, chilling, relaxing, getting to know each other, share a bathroom together. Let's start now, man. Let's just start now. What do you say?
Start what?
The journey, man. The journey. I mean, it's messed up in me that as one gradually gains experience, one loses one's youth. So forget that. Let's be youthful, my friend. Let's make youth our bitch.
What do you mean?
Georgie walks over to the bunk bed and from his bag pulls out a bottle of scotch.
Let's drink.
I can't.
What does that mean? Are you allergic? Did you get hives and stuff? Break out?
No, I just don't do that. Don't get me wrong, I drink, like, a lot. I love to drink. I just don't want to go there right now.
Go where?
You know, I just don't want to go the drunk.
Who's the drunk?
Well, you know, the bad place.
The bad place. Ha! Just have a sip.
I really should.
Have a sip.
No, I really...
A sip?
Okay, I've never...
Sip.
I'm just... Okay.
Marc hesitates, but then takes a large gulp from the scotch bottle, treating it like a bottle of water. Although he swallows most of it, a significant amount spurts out.
Pro.
I've never had a drink before.
You could have fooled me. Figured you were a regular. What's their favorite bar called again? The drunk? Have another.
Marc takes another large gulp from the bottle, but is successful in his anti-regurgitation.
This is strong. I already feel something.
That's good, Marc Andre Marc.
Marc passes the bottle to Georgie. He looks at the finished canvases.
Are these yours? They're good. Really good.
I'm fortunate. Always have been. I've known this is my calling in life. This is my destiny.
When did you know?
Well, it's weird. I always just drew and diddled and daddled when I was younger, but man, when I was in this arts high school and I would draw in art class, the way people responded to what I drew, it just gave me such confidence, like a crazy energy, a sweet feeling. I loved it. I loved the attention, the awards, accolades that I would get, and the girls, parties. I mean, just for me, like I'm some sort of quarterback. Just good times, you know?
Yeah.
What about you? Why are you here?
Same thing. I mean, I don't do it for the attention of girls and parties.
You what?
I don't know. I've always had a feeling that I'm destined for it. Like some sort of voice or person inside me that has always told me that this is my life, that art is my life.
Yeah. Art is your life. That's cool. It's my life. I get you, man. It's like something's brewing inside us, right?
Yeah. Something like that.
Tell you what, Marc Andre Marc.
It's just Marc.
I know, man. I'm just messing with you. I'll tell you what. Even though it's impossible that neither of us will get to our destiny plans, maybe by talking together, maybe we could mutually strengthen the feeling, your feeling and my feeling, that something is ripening inside us. I'd like that.
I'd like that too.
Well, then it's settled. Here's to our journey, Marc. Just Marc.
to our journey, Georgie, like gee whiz.
They share a few more sips while staring out their window. Scene 5, a few days later. A college art studio. 3 easels, 3 stools. A female student, Jennifer Rowland, sits at one of the stools with her paints and brush nearby. Professor Robert Gachet paces in his classroom. Georgie and Marc Andre enter hurriedly and grab their seats at the remaining stools.
You have come here to be artists, yes?
Yes.
Ah, you are wrong. You are already artists, yes?
The professor strolls around the class.
What is art, Miss...
Jenny Rowland? Art is life. It is everything that surrounds us.
Good. What is life, then, Mr...
Georgie Gunnigoo. Life is different for all of us. It is our ticket, our proof of being here to experience and appreciate art.
Very interesting indeed, yes. You see, friends, that life and art are undefined, progressing, evolving, moving with time. They can be anything you title them to be. What do you title life and art to be, Mr...
Who? I'm not sure, sir. I have nothing that comes to mind.
Mr. Hoop, nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Life is devotion. Art is devotion.
Very good, yes. Devotion is the art of life. Ha! Very good indeed. You will learn in this sanctuary of colors and visions how much devotion will determine your art and your life. Believe that with every canvas you breathe, your art in a successful slide of your brush can quickly turn into a sad splatter of paint. Your devotion to the maturing of your skill is an odyssey that will shake, that we shall take together. An odyssey that will be peppered with triumph and tragedy. Do you want to paint now? Good. Then let our odyssey begin. Amazing. I want you to pick one brush and one color and to paint what you feel right this moment. What do you feel? Are you happy? Joyful? Odd? Are you sad? Alone? Distant? Are you in love? Out of love? Afraid of love? Searching for love? What do you feel? Begin.
The professor exits. After a slight pause, all the students, except for Marc, work away at their paintings. On the screen, we see several different single-colored paintings being drawn. A choreographed theatrical time lapse as the characters paint, all except Marc. The professor returns a short while later.
All right, cease! Let's talk about what you've all been working on.
The professor makes his way behind Miss Rowland's piece.
Good. What do you see? What did you feel?
I see adventure. I felt happiness. The search for...
Love, yes?
Something like that.
Everything like that. Your brush marks are fluid but heavy at times, bleaching the canvas. You've chosen pink. Pink is a quiet color, the color of love. But pink is a mix of red, the color of courage, confidence, desire, and a mix of white, which symbolizes purity, stressing fresh beginnings.
Cool.
Yes. Very cool. Nice work, Miss Rowland.
The professor moves behind Georgie's piece.
I chose yellow.
Ah, you think this is yellow?
Well, a tint of yellow.
A tint of yellow? Mr. Gunnigoo, this is gold. Your color is gold.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Interesting.
What is it, Professor?
You have vision and imagination well coupled with a great sense of structure and creativity.
Your hand is confident, well-versed in angles, in touch, and finish.
Thank you, sir.
Not finished, Mr. Gunnagoo. Your hand is also arrogant. And obviously, you need to learn your colors. You chose gold for a tint of yellow. What is gold, hmm? Gold is personal power, wealth, the need for success. But gold does symbolize the enjoyment and love of life. Interesting and impressive work, Mr. Gunnagoo. Class, you are an ensemble of artists in here, but Mr. Gunnagoo can be helpful in aiding your process should you accept to learn from him.
Thank you, sir.
I'm not finished, Mr. Gunnagoo. Just be wary of his eagerness.
The professor makes his way to behind Mark's painting.
What is wrong, Mr. Hoop?
I drew nothing, sir. I tried, but I had no feelings.
This may be an important tool in your odyssey, Mr. Hoop, or it may be your biggest obstacle in creation. Students, Mr. Hoop has not touched his canvas, leaving it blank. Why?
Because he had no feelings, Professor.
Shut up, Georgie, I don't need your help.
Ah, so you do have feelings, Mr. Hoop. Fear? Perhaps anger?
No, sir.
Then why is your canvas empty, yet your brush has been dipped in paint?
I'm not sure, sir.
Purple. The color of magic and mystery. The desire to remove obstacles. The search for peace of mind. Mr. Hoop, you will need to trust yourself when you paint. To not paint when I have asked you to paint is to defy. To defy is to feel defiance or hesitation, anxiety. These are all feelings, Mr. Hoop. Do not deny them. As artists, we do not have time to philosophize about our art. We must not think, but act. There's no explanation for it. You must just feel how things should go, yes?
Yes.
Lovely. Welcome to our Odyssey class. Dismissed.
Scene 6, later that day. Georgie and Mark's college dorm room. Mark enters, followed by Georgie in mid-conversation.
Mark, wait.
Don't talk to me, Georgie. I just want to be alone.
Lighten up, Mark. It was the first class. We've got years to go.
Professor Gachet made a fool of me today.
What? He was trying to help you, man. He gave you the best lesson.
No. No one wants to help me. They just want to make fun of me some way or another. It's all they're doing.
You're not going to get anywhere thinking like that.
Easy for you to say. He practically told everyone that we should go to you for help.
Mark, listen to me. He's a good teacher. He's smart, enthusiastic. He actually cares about each of us in our own way. I mean, we're here to learn, Mark, and he's worth learning from.
You don't think he's just mocking me?
Why would he mock you?
I don't know. Everyone always has.
Hey, this is a good school, man. I mean, you wouldn't be here if that wasn't true. I definitely wouldn't be here.
I'm here because my dad got me here, not because of what I could do. All my other teachers, my whole life, just made fun of everything I've ever drawn.
Okay. But do you honestly think that he's like them?
I don't know. Not really. No, I guess not.
So give him a chance. Yes?
I don't need your help, you know.
Who said I want to help you? I love gold, remember? Besides, I want to help Jennifer Rowland. She's cute. Hey, I think she likes both of us.
You think so?
Oh, man, I mean, I have no idea what she could possibly see in your pathetic self.
Thanks.
I mean, I see what she sees in me.
You are so egotistical.
I mean, look at me. My work, my face.
Oh, shut up. You're so crazy.
Georgie and Mark have a mini wrestling or pillow fight, with Georgie eventually laying down on the bottom bunk of the bed. Mark sits near him.
Thanks.
For what?
You know what.
You're welcome. Get some sleep, Mark.
I will. Good night, Midas.
Clever. Good night. I've got nothing. Good night, Barney.
Yeah, no, that rebuttal, it's way too late.
Georgie slowly falls to sleep. Mark takes a moment and watches him. Eventually, he's motivated to go to his school bag and pull out his Van Gogh book. He sneaks away from the bunk beds, opens the book, and flips through some pages. Marc flips through the pages until he comes upon the painting of Gauguin's armchair, 1888. The chair appears on the screen, eventually transforming the scene into the room the chair was painted in.
You're wasting our time with being here. Wasting it on meaningless things, relations, desires.
I'm here to learn, am I not? I'm not sure how by learning from others I'm endangering your wishes.
You are deceiving yourself by creating reliance on things you need not. People you need not. Your destiny is clear and forthcoming.
When? When, then, you appear and keep telling me, no, assuring me that I'm some next great thing, but not one single line I crease on any canvas is noticed by anyone. I've never even made a single comment on a single thing I've drawn.
Then I have failed you as well.
I understand what you want from me, but how can you be so sure that I do not need anything or anyone other than you?
Because I know your destiny, Marc.
Which is what? To be you? To complete you? Where do I fit in?
The destiny of man is his own soul. But because of God's will, our fate, our souls are linked, and I have glimpsed at the fate that awaits you, and it is great. It is beautiful. It is filled with awe, wonderment, and joy. Believe me, Marc. Your day will come. And you will shine as bright as any night star, but you do not need them. You do not need anyone but yourself. And me.
What if I want, need more than you and me?
Like what? Like who? Your talentless nitwit of a friend? Your pathetic rat of a professor? Scholars, professors, academians are hypocrites and Pharisees. As for your friend, you are pity to him, an enterprise, a charity. He will betray you. He cares. His cares and passions are for his own.
Maybe you're right. But I'm going to find that out for myself. I'm very happy to have such a good teacher as Professor Gachet, and as for Georgie, he is a very interesting man, and I am wholly confident we will do many things together. He will probably produce a great deal here, but I know that perhaps I will too, without you.
So be it. You want to learn? Go learn. You will regret your defiance. But I will forgive your lack of faith when you come back to me.
I will not regret, and I will not come back.
Marc, I want what is best for you. I'm only warning you.
I don't need your warnings. I don't need you.
Very well. I'm sorry.
Marc takes one last look at his mentor as the scene fades away. He stands alone on stage for a moment. Scene 7, theatrical time lapse. The college art studio. Three easels, three stools. Georgie and Jennifer Rowland are already at their stools as Marc enters and sits at his. A theatrical time lapse to cover 3 years scored by fitting music. As the years progress, the screens highlight the numerous paintings created by the class. From time to time within this painter's ballet, we see Professor Gachet lecture and exit. This continues and repeats and continues until 3 years later.
Class! Class. Your attention, please, yes? Ah, years passing. We are all faring well in our odyssey together. I am pleased that we are nearing the end of our third year together, and what better way for us to reflect than for me to express to you what we shall fence with fluid, feathered touches and an eye for judgment and critical introspection. The art of self-portrait next semester! Hooray! Oh, yes. The feeling is obviously not mutual. This is good, yes? A new challenge! We will work slowly these few weeks as we end the semester, but please prepare yourself for the months following your summer break. Except, of course, for those of you that will be here during the summer making up the grades you have tarnished this semester, yes? Excellent. Mr. Gunnagoom, if I may speak with you privately before you depart. Class, exeunt.
Georgie leaves his stool and meets Professor Gachet away from Marc. Jennifer Roland gingerly walks up to Marc, dropping her bag on the ground.
Hey, Marc.
Oh, hey, Jennifer.
Are you excited for the summer?
Yeah. Lots of big plans, I guess.
Really?
No, not really. My mom's coming to see me since I have to, you know.
Yeah. Sorry to hear that you have to take his still life makeup class this summer.
It's okay. I want to. Without all these makeup classes he lets me take, I probably would have flunked out by now. Anyway, I like him as a teacher.
Yeah, I like him too. What else do you like?
I don't know. Lots of things. I like scotch, I know that. I think I like post-impressionism, except for Gogh and...
No, I mean, what else do you like?
Well, I think I like you.
What's going on, kids? How about we go out and celebrate, huh?
I can't tonight.
Why not?
I'm trying to finish this piece for this thing. I'll probably be here the next couple of nights. Deadline's in a week.
That's great, Marc. Well, I hope this thing works out. We'll celebrate when you're done. I've got good news for you, Marky. How about you, Jenny? You want to hang out?
Georgie pulls Jennifer away from Marc while walking out of the class.
Sure. That would be great.
Marc watches them walk away and turns to his painting. He gives a few looks back to Jennifer's exit, reflects, then turns to his canvas.
Hey.
Hey.
I forgot my bag.
Oh. Here it is.
Thanks. You sure you can't come out just for a little bit?
I'll see you guys later, probably. I'll try to wrap up soon.
Good. I'd like that. And I like scotch and post-impressionism. And you, too. I'll let you get back to work. Can't wait to see you later. Good luck, Marc.
Jennifer smiles at Marc, then hurries off. Marc takes a deep breath, feeling it. Turns to his painting, and without hesitation, dives in. Moments later, another mini time lapse, but within this same night. Marc works hard at his painting, and has a fresh choreography to his movements as he brushes. However, what he paints remains absent from the scenic panels. Throughout this time lapse, Marc has visions of Jennifer re-entering the stage. He watches each of her entrances, and turns to his painting on each of her exits. He works feverishly until his fatigue catches up with him, slumbering him.
Marc, everything's going well, yes?
Professor Gachet, I'm so sorry, I thought I was alone.
I did not mean to scare you, Marc. Still getting used to this past week to you being here so very late.
Yes.
This, a piece for your senior portfolio, yes?
Oh, no, sir. I'm working on this for a competition. One of the ones you posted on the art board, I thought I'd finally give one a shot.
Oh, yes. Very good, Marc. I'm pleased to hear you are working hard for great opportunities, yes? Carry on.
The professor walks away. Marc watches him leave from behind, but the professor stops himself, sighs, then returns to Marc, who has by now returned to his painting.
Marc.
Yes, professor.
Forgive me, I've never been certain about when or how I could say this to you.
If this is about the paper I wrote on Gauguin, I just don't like him, sir. I hope my arguments were warranted.
No, Marc. I greatly enjoyed your paper. As I have with all your papers the past few years, you are an impeccable student of art and its history. You have a tremendous gift in understanding, appreciating, yes? The art of others.
Thank you, sir.
Don't thank me yet, Marc. This is much more difficult than I anticipated, Marc. How long have I been your teacher now?
3 years, sir.
3 years, yes. Marc, through the years of teaching you, of being your friend, I hope, I've realized that your work is very...
good, sir?
I'm afraid not. Your work, Marc, lacks an element that only you can acquire and develop. Your work is always incomplete, yes?
I don't understand, sir.
Marc, every artist has a voice, a vision, a faith. Your passion for your work is very obvious to me, and it is powerful, but your work itself seems to...
be funny, comic, as many have called it before?
I don't want to bring you down, Marc. I have greatly enjoyed you as a student and inspiring artist. I believe, however, that you may be wasting your time, true talents, in the production of art, perhaps. Perhaps you should consider studying art history or criticism. There are many prestigious opportunities in such fields.
Sir, I believed in my work for too many years to give up now. I don't know how to explain this to you, but I've always known that one day everyone will understand my work, and they will finally see the beauty I create.
I just don't want you to make mistakes that have been made by others. I don't want you to go through your life following an unobtainable fantasy. A mistaken fate, yes?
Life and art are undefined, sir. I don't intend on quitting, Professor.
Very well. Very good. Please forgive me. I hope I have not...
You are a wonderful professor, Professor.
Marc?
Yes.
This piece you were working on, it is stronger than all the others. Different, a little. Do not forget where or from whom this new strength has stemmed.
Yes? Yes.
He exits. Marc watches him leave and turns proudly to his canvas. For a moment, Jennifer enters in his fantasy. He completes his final brushes as she disappears. He takes one last look at his work. He proudly lifts it from the easel and exits. Scene 8. The college dorm room. Georgie is nearly naked, lying on the bottom bunk. Marc enters excitedly.
Georgie, I did it! I had my phone interview, and it went great. They want to see it, Georgie. They want to see it. I'm a finalist.
See what? Well, that's great. I mean, depending on what they want to see, right? What's going on?
I filled out an application for this competition for a book cover, and they called me, and they said that they want to see the piece that they asked for. It's a romance novel or something. Good, I mean, great money and a chance to be on the cover of a book. I mean, this is great. Tomorrow, I'm going to take the train to the city to show them this campus. I can't wait for them to see it. They're going to love it.
They haven't seen it yet?
Not yet. They wanted to, but I told them since they called me for an interview that I wanted to create something brand new. That's why I've pretty much slept in the studio all week. I mean, they asked me to send a picture, but because of our program and... who knows, probably Professor Cachet put in a good word for me. They want to actually see me. They want to see my painting, and wow, isn't this great, Georgie? Finally, I really needed this. We should celebrate, my friend, after I take a shower. That is, I mean, I still...
Jennifer walks out of the bathroom door nearly naked herself. She gathers her stuff during the preceding dialogue.
I'm gonna go.
You sure you don't want to stick around? Mark's got some great news.
I better go. I'll see you guys later.
Okay, Jenny. Thanks for another great night. See you soon.
Georgie heads back to his lower bunk bed.
I'm sorry, Marc. You said that you would... I'm sorry.
She exits.
Oh my God, Marc. I wasted my time with nothings the last 3 years. Jennifer is a solid person, if you know what I mean. Thank God she broke up with that jerk. You okay?
Fine.
Good. Oh, wow. That's great about the interview tomorrow. I've got some pretty big news for you, too. I've been waiting almost a week to tell you. Okay. Are you ready? Good. So, it seems that just like Professor Gachet helped you with this romance novel thing, he helped me get an impossible internship that I thought I would never get. Can you believe it?
What internship?
I'm off to Torino next year for senior year. Torino, as in Italia, at the Torino Museum of Modern Art. Marc, I'm set. I am set. I'm off to paradise.
You never told me about this?
Are you kidding? If I thought I had a chance, oh, man, I didn't have a chance. But they saw my pictures and my work, and that Professor Gachet really helped me out.
What about Jennifer?
Jennifer? Oh, please, she's going to Denver or Salt Lake City or something. She's fast track. She's graduating in a few weeks. I thought you knew that. Anyway, she's just a girl. A Torino is more than a girl, Marky. Torino was our shot. You and me, Marky, as soon as I settle there, our future is set, Marc. It is set.
But our future is here, Georgie. I thought we were going to finish school together and maybe start an artist combine, our own gallery or something?
Yeah. This is going to get us going, Marc. This is a type of hookup that we need. I'm just going to go there and do my best to get us set. You and me, Marc. Man, I can't wait. You can maybe fly out during winter break. Well, that is if professor doesn't force you to take winter classes. I'm just kidding. Who knows? I mean, your paintings might be all over romance novels by then. I'm so happy that you're here, Marc. This is great for us.
Yeah, it's great, Georgie. I'm really happy for you.
For us, Marc, for us. Let's celebrate.
Georgie rushes to find booze.
Oh, darn, I'm totally out of alcohol. That Jennifer, she's a drinker. All she wanted to do this whole week is stay here and drink. I mean, it was crazy. She would sit up on your bunk, drinking all of our scotch, asking about you. Hey, I know. I'm going to run to the store and get us something to drink to celebrate your romance novels and my romance town. Right? Man, I'm so proud of us, Marc. So proud.
Georgie puts clothes on during the preceding speech and eventually hugs Marc.
Our odyssey is happening, man. Yes? It's happening.
He exits. Marc takes in the room and looks up at his bunk. Marc travels the stage and with complete disappointment and a growing rage. Fighting his tears, he looks at the blank canvas and destroys it, kneels, then quiet. Scene 10, a month later. Marc enters his room. Georgie is packing some of his belongings into a suitcase at his bed. Marc, without acknowledging Georgie, goes directly to his desk and sits. He goes through his school bag, pulling out some books. An uncomfortable air seeps.
You know, I leave tomorrow. I'm sorry, Marc. I'm sorry things didn't work out with the romance thing, but I don't see how you need to take it out on me. Why don't you say anything to me? It's been nearly a month, and you don't even look at me, Marc. What is it? I'm your friend. Please just tell me what's going on with you.
I just want to be left alone.
You have been alone. How much more alone do you want to be?
Completely.
Fine. You know, it's true that every day has its own evil, but it has its own good, too, you know? I mean, you and me, Marc, we're the good. Our friendship is the good. Everything that I am has everything to do with who you are, and I'm fortunate for that. I don't want to lose that, Marc. I'm scared. I'm going off to a crazy, strange land, a paradise, to try to do something that one day will help us be great.
Help you.
What?
To help you be great, Georgie.
Us, Marc. I'm doing this to help us be great.
You're so full of lies. You're so full of yourself, and it's pathetic that you actually convince yourself that the things you do are for someone else.
Lies? Lies. Sure, Marc. I'm full of lies. I'm full of just me, huh? What about you, Marc? What about you, Marc?
What about me, Georgie?
What's happening to you? Why can't you be happy for me? I'm going off on a great new odyssey. And I want you to know that the only reason that I'm going, that I even have a chance of going, is because of you, Marc. You. You're my best friend.
I've been an enterprise to you. Charity. I know deep down you pity me.
Pity you? Marc, where are you getting all this stuff? You are a man of remarkable intelligence, whom I hold the highest esteem, and tomorrow I leave you with so much regret. What in that makes you think that for one moment I don't care about you?
You're trying to trick me like you do everyone else. You only care about yourself. I'm glad you're leaving for Italy. I'm glad you'll be out of my life.
Well, you are alone then, because I don't feel that way at all.
I don't care how you feel.
Marc, please stop this.
Get out of here. Just stop talking.
Marc gets up and heads to the bathroom door, leaning on the sink by the mirror. Georgie follows but stops by the door.
I've never seen you like this, Marc. You're not yourself. Stop this.
Leave me alone, Georgie!
On the screens, one or two of Van Gogh's self-portraits come to life as Marc stares in the mirror.
I'm not going to spend my last night here losing my best friend for nothing, for jealousy.
A few more self-portraits appear.
Jealousy? You think I'm jealous of you, Georgie?
I didn't mean it like that, Mark. You've just been acting so strange since I told you about Italy. I can't tell you what's going on with you. No one can. Even Jenny says that...
Jenny? Jenny's a whore. And you're a whore, too. You paint because all you care about is fame, money. You don't care about art at all. All you care...
More self-portraits as Mark grips the straight razor from the sink top. He raises it and menacingly walks towards Georgie.
Mark, come on. You don't have to act crazy. I'm just worried about you. Look, let's drop it. You want to be left alone? Fine. I'm gone tomorrow. You'll be alone.
You abuse people and make them think you actually care when all you want is to steal inspiration and throw your judgment at them after you're done with them. You're diseased and the very reason that art is sick. Cause of you and all those like you.
Mark and Georgie fence around their dorm room.
You think there is a great fire inside your soul, but no one will ever come to warm themselves by it. All they will ever see from you is a wisp of smoke.
Mark, what's going on? Snap out of it, Mark. This isn't you. Stop this, Mark. This is not you.
Who are you? This is me, Georgie. I am Van Gogh.
What? What are you saying?
You are me. I am Van Gogh.
Mark lunges at his best friend with the razor. Georgie quickly punches Mark as he does, sending him and the razor to the ground. Mark rises and starts punching Georgie, landing him on the ground. As they wrestle, Georgie finally grabs one of the easels from by the bed and whips it at Mark, who flies backwards. Georgie gets up, staring at his friend in disbelief. Mark moans in pain. Georgie reaches for him, but thinks twice. He quickly grabs his suitcase and the rest of his belongings, broken by the sight of his friend.
I'm so sorry, Mark. You need help. You need help.
Georgie exits, shaken. Mark lies on the ground for a little while. Eventually, nearly possessed, he rises, taking in his friend's exit. He struggles at the realization of what has happened. He notices the razor and walks to it, picking it up, making his way slowly to the bathroom.
Good, Mark. Very good. I'm proud of you. In order to put our soul in our work, at times you have to lose your mind in the process.
Mark, surrounded by the Van Gogh self-portrait, stares at himself in the mirror. Van Gogh enters and stares in the mirror with him.
I warned you that all these fleeting desires would be nothing but pauses in our fate. You should have listened to me, Mark.
I should have listened.
I am your friend, your father, your life.
You are my life.
Mark raises the razor near his ear.
This may be the scar to remind you that my voice is the one to hear, to listen to.
I will listen
Mark
to you.
Mark starts to cut the top of his ear. As he does, the self-portraits begin to be doused in red paint.
Your friend achieved little. He is worthless to you, to me.
The dousing of red paint slowly turns to purple as Mark struggles.
Worthless to you and... No. Our destiny, Mark. You are fulfilling our destiny.
Mark stops ripping his ear and drops the razor. The canvas is turned to purple only.
No, what have I done? What are you doing? Don't you betray me again.
Georgie, I've lost him. I've lost my only friend.
I am your friend, Mark.
No, not like this. This is no friendship. Oh, Georgie.
You don't need him, Mark. He's not important in our plan.
Mark grabs a towel and covers his bleeding ear. He rushes to Georgie's bed and lies in it.
Mark. Don't you dare deny me again. I chose you. I chose you, Mark.
And you chose wrong.
Mark. Answer me.
Van Gogh fades away. Mark eventually falls asleep. Lights change. In the middle of the night, Georgie enters stealthily. He takes in his friend sleeping on his bed. He puts a letter by him and goes to one side of the stage. Scene 11, the next morning. Mark wakes up. He rises, and as he does, the letter drops to the ground. He looks at it, rips it open.
Mark, I still don't know what exactly happened to us, and to tell you the truth, I don't really care. You made every moment of every day of every week, well, you get the picture, very special. I want you to know that I will never forget you, and all I hope is that when you're done feeling the way you did, we will be friends again. The best of friends. I'll be waiting for you, Mark. You may not agree now, but you will. What I'm doing is for us, Mark. Us. I will not stop thinking about you until the day gold and purple are reunited. You're my best friend, Marc Andre Marc. My only true friend. Please remember and come back to that. Come back to me, Mark. Georgie. P.S. Thanks for the shiner.
I've never had a black eye before. To tell you the truth, it looks great on me. Might even make a self-portrait.
Marc takes one final look at the letter, a chagrined smile enveloping him. Scene 12, 1 year later. Professor Cachet is finishing up some classroom duties. Marc walks up to his easel and stool and stares at it momentarily.
Nostalgia, yes?
Sir?
You are feeling nostalgia.
A beautiful word for a most tragic but useful thing.
Yes, nostalgia.
There may be a time in life when one is tired of everything and feels as if all one does is wrong.
And there may be some truth in it. Do you think this is a feeling one must try to forget and to banish? Or is it the longing for faith which one must not fear, but cherish to see if it may bring us some good?
I'm not sure.
It is the longing for faith which leads us to make a choice which we never regret.
I'm not sure, sir.
Let us keep courage and try to be patient and gentle. And not mind being a golden eccentric. And make distinction between good and evil.
I do miss him, if that's what you mean.
I mean what you want me to mean. But I miss him too, yes?
Yes.
I fear I may have failed you as a mentor, Marc.
You have done no such thing, Professor Cachet.
Perhaps. I know that we have never agreed on your work, Marc. I have been, at times, brutal in my teaching and thoughts on what you have drawn, but my view on what your strokes have created should not be taken as the final interpretation, yes?
Yes. You are a friend. A good friend, Robert.
Our odyssey is nearly complete. You have been a great sailor, yes?
And you have been a great captain. Will you be at my senior thesis exhibit tonight?
Well, I hope to. If I do not come, Marc, it is because...
It is because you have been there this whole time. I understand.
Marc?
Yes, Professor?
Devotion is the art of life. Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Antio, Cathigatus.
Adieu, Marc.
Scene 13, that evening. The art school gallery, a table with bottles of wine and trays of cheese. Marc enters, putting the finishing touches on his arrangements. He takes in all of his work on the walls all around the room, including the fourth, us. He walks over to the table and pours himself a glass of wine. As he takes his first nervous sip, two art jocks walk in and go over to the table and start going around the exhibit, mocking and laughing at the paintings. They use us, the audience, as part of the crowd that is there. A time lapse begins with the art jocks going back to the table from time to time, refilling their drinks and snacks. During this time lapse, Marc eventually sits on the floor, glass in hand. By the end of it, the glass is empty and he is alone. The table has nothing left. Marc reaches under the table where one bottle remains. He pours himself a glass until Adeline Signac enters with flyer in hand, a breathtaking creature. Marc does not notice her until she giggles at the first painting she sees. She giggles again at the next one. Marc, frustrated but without moving from his spot.
The exhibit is closed.
It says here on this flyer that it starts the date and finishes at 10.
Yes, and it is...
Marc looks at his watch.
8:15. Well... Doesn't matter. If you're here for wine and crackers and cheese, there's none left, so you might as well go.
Mais c'est ridicule. No cheese, no crackers? That's okay. But no wine? That's bad. What's that?
What?
That.
Grape juice.
Can I have some?
Fine. I'll pour you the last of the wine.
Merci.
She returns to looking at his work, giggling from time to time. Marc returns with a glass for her.
There. Can you leave now?
Oh, t'es vraiment méchant, toi.
I don't know what you're saying.
That's the point.
I'm sorry, I just figured you're here to eat crackers and cheese and drink the wine.
I am here to eat the crackers and cheese and drink the wine.
Oh.
But I'm also here to see your work.
How do you know it's my work?
I don't. Easy? I guess so. I'm sorry. Am I hurting your feelings?
I'm used to it.
How could you be? I never hurt your feelings before.
No, I just... Never mind.
Are you a comedian?
Why do you think that? No.
Oh.
Yeah.
My name is Aline. Or in America, they call me Adeline.
Adeline, that's kind of pretty.
And you?
Me? Pretty?
They call... No. What is your name?
Oh, I'm Marc-André.
Marc-André?
Never heard my name said like that.
C'est bon, non, pour toi.
I don't under... Right, that's the point.
Did you make all these?
Yes.
Why?
Because I had to.
Huh. Did you make any of these because you wanted to?
Homme
is homme, which is man in Francais.
Right. Who are you?
I'm Adeline, I told you.
No, who are you? Why are you here?
It's a long story.
I'd like to know it.
Well, I'm a writer. I'm doing a tour of some schools here for the year. I won a prize that gives me the chance to come here to America and read my work, my poetry.
You're a poet?
I am an author, a writer.
Cool. Wish I could write.
But you paint. Poetry surrounds us everywhere, but putting it on paper is, alas, not so easy as looking at it.
Yes, but poetry, writing, it's like 1,000 brush strokes on every line. How long have you been doing that?
Since I was young. My father died when I was young, and he always read to me stories from, everyone. Keats, Shakespeare, Rousseau, Michelet. So when he could no longer read to me, I now write. So hopefully, well, it's stupid.
Hopefully what? I won't think it's stupid.
Hopefully now I read my stories to him. Maybe he listens wherever he is.
So you're here now, for good?
No, I am here on tour. I'm visiting the best schools with the best French programs. I read my poetry in seminars. I have a good agent now, and I'm working on a novel called Cien. I'm almost finished, and I go back soon to France because my agent, well, thinks that I will do very well.
How well?
Oh, I don't know.
What does he think?
It doesn't matter.
I didn't mean to make you uncomfortable. I just felt excited.
He thinks I may be famous one day. I don't wish this, but I do.
That's great. That's great, Adeline.
I like the way you say my name. Like music it is. My friends are right.
I love the way you say mine. Do you want to maybe get out of here?
I'm sorry, Marc-André. I didn't mean to.
No. I meant get out of here with me.
Tais-toi, mignon, Marc.
That's a yes, right?
Oui. But only if we get some real wine.
I thought this is real wine.
Do we? Yeah. Come on, before we lose our bee from this bottle.
Our bee?
Yes, from drinking.
Ah, yes, our buzz. That's cute.
They walk off, magic stirring in their every step. As they exit stage, we briefly see the panels come to life with an array of Van Gogh's paintings. They disappear. Scene 14, an hour or so later. The college dorm room. Marc and Adeline stumble in with a bottle in hand. Marc searches for a bottle opener. Adeline takes in his space. Marc can't keep his eyes off her and is trying to open the bottle. He messes up and the cork breaks, spilling red wine all over him.
Do you want help? You know, in France you can be beheaded for putting cork in the wine.
Oh, there's no cork in the wine. It's mostly on me. See? Here and here and here? I'm sorry, I just realized I don't have any glasses here.
Adeline takes and grabs the bottle, taking a sip.
I will keep this secret if you do.
Oui.
They sit on the bottom bunk, sipping.
This one is your bed?
No, that was my roommate's. He's gone now. He is in Italy.
Ah, Italia. I like Italia very much.
I like you very much.
This is moving very fast. Love can be difficult. Dangerous.
Love always brings difficulties, that's true, but the good side of it is that it gives us energy.
energy.
For life, for love. I've never felt anything like this, Adeline, but whatever it is, it's something I want to continue to feel. There is something so amazing, so beautiful, so wonderful in everything that you are. I don't know how to describe it. It's like some sort of...
Arrête de parler, Marc.
What did you say?
Arrête de parler.
She kisses him, her fingers skating on his skin. As the kiss continues, Marc embraces her with absolute passion. They make love. The love scene is another time lapse. When they finish, they lie on the floor. Marc holds her tightly, but he eventually lets go.
What will we do, Marc?
What do you mean? Do you like me?
Thank God. I feel something deeper than that.
As do I.
I leave soon, Marc. I don't have the energy to love you from afar.
I don't either. I want to love you from nearby.
I don't understand.
Can I come with you? To France? I promise I won't be in your way.
You want to come with me?
Oui. I've got nothing keeping me here.
This is not possible. Love does not work this way. Only in...
Poems and paintings?
Oui. To même, Jean-Marc.
Yes. I am you, Adeline. Love, amour.
They kiss passionately, and for a little while. As they kiss, we eventually freeze in a tableau, and Adeline has fallen asleep. Marc lies down, watching her. He reflects, then rises and grabs a sketchbook and crayon. As she sleeps, he draws her, a time lapse. His entire drawing process can be seen on the screens. It is beautiful, a wonderful drawing. He sees the screens, all of them portraying her as she slumbers. Complete satisfaction and joy swallows him.
This doesn't change anything, Marc.
I knew you would come and try to make this something it's not.
But it isn't, Marc. This is a passing fancy. You are always relying on inspiration from futile things. Do not quench your inspiration and your imagination. Do not become a slave to any model.
I'm not a slave to anything, even if you think I am.
She's an infatuation.
You are wrong. You're scared because this is the first time I've ever drawn anything that has nothing to do with you. I drew this because of me, because of how I feel. How my soul feels, and you've got nothing to do with it.
Confidence. That's nice to hear, Marc. But this too, like your friend, like your teacher, like your mother, will only add to your realization that everything and everyone you claim as inspirations are nothing but deceivers, charlatans, to our work.
No, you are. I'm done with you. Do you hear me? I'm done with your destiny, your vision, your soul this and soul that. I'm tired of pretending to be some future light and some shadow. We are done. You hear me? We are done. This is the end.
This is just the beginning, Marc. I know your destiny. This is just the beginning.
Marc finds his Van Gogh book, opens it, and starts to rip pages from the book. The pages appear on the screen.
No. This is the end. The end of this and the end of anything you ever hoped for. Your rebirth, from my art, it will never happen. I will never need you. Never.
He continues to rip pages as they float upon the screen. Adeline has woken up and witnesses the last few moments.
This is your destiny!
You are done. You hear me? You're done. It's finished. Everything I do from now on has nothing to do with you. You are not me, and I am not you. I am Marc Andre Hoop.
Marc.
Blackout. End of Act One.
We're going to take a little tin here, so feel free to go to the bathroom and such.
It's actually after 13.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Hey, Pasha. Hush. Where's Cody?
Charles de Gaulle Airport. Marc enters with Adeline pushing an airport cart while they're with their luggage. As they wait as Adeline takes her cell phone out of her purse.
You're sure you're okay?
Yes, just a little anxious, nervous. I've never left my country, you know?
I know what that's like, Marc, but you're not alone.
You have me.
You have me. Marc?
Yes, yes, I'm fine, I'm great.
I just need to make a call.
To who?
A surprise. It won't take long. I'm right here.
No problem. I'll just look around, get our mind off stuff. My mind, I mean.
The call, shall we?
So many people here. So many different people. Destiny.
Destiny.
Marc walks further and further away from Adeline, who is still on the phone.
Stop. Calm down, Marc. This is it. Breathe. This is it, isn't it, Marc? I'm here. France, Paris, La Ville Lumière, the city of lights, the city of love.
Marc delivers these lines while looking at us, but eventually turns back to Adeline, who is now in a full embrace with an unknown man. Marc hesitates, but his rage builds, and he rushes towards them. He walks up to the hugging couple and grabs the man, hitting him in the face.
No, Marc, no, this is my brother. This is Bernard.
Marc steps away from the fallen body. The man, Bernard Signac, a scruffy man, gets up rubbing his jaw. He faces off against Marc.
I'm sorry, Adeline. I didn't know what was going on. I thought you were in trouble.
C'est lui, ton mec? Les socons, quand y'a va, t'as vu ce que si?
I'm sorry.
C'est bon, écoute que ton mec t'a
I just...
Sérieux? Avec quoi? Quand y'a un frère embrassé sorcier, c'est attaqué? Quand y'a d'Américains?
Oh, c'est bon. Laisse-le tranquille.
I'm sorry.
Il dit quoi là?
Sorry. Pardonnez-moi.
Pardonne-moi? Ça qu'on va, dis-lui, je me fous de la sorte, pardonne-moi. Va t'inquiète, Américain.
What did he say? He seems really mad, and I think he keeps repeating American angrily.
He said he accepts your apology because you're American. He likes them, you Americans.
Qu'est-ce qu'il vient de dire? Putain?
Il a dit qu'il me protégeait.
Ouais, protéger mon cul. Dis-lui s'il sait quelque chose comme ça une autre fois, je la mets au fond de l'acier.
What did he say?
He said he appreciates you trying to protect me.
Salut!
What was that?
It means honor. It is your honorable. Salut.
Okay, cool. Salut.
Mark reaches out to pat Bernard on the shoulder. Bernard backs up with a pseudo ninja pose.
Touche pas.
I just.
No, me touche pas.
I just want to.
Touche pas. Et foyer me merde de con de chier.
What did he say there? That didn't sound positive. He doesn't look very happy.
He said a French prayer for you. Mm. We better go. Allez, Bernard, allons-y.
Bernard starts to exit with the car, giving one more threatening look to Mark.
Jerk.
Salaud.
Well, I think he likes you. Usually he says nothing to my boyfriends. He likes you, I know it.
Are you sure?
No. But I like you. My hero. My salaud.
That's a curse word, isn't it?
Yes, but a good one.
What does it mean?
It means let's go to Paris.
They kiss and exit. Scene two, an hour later. A Montmartre apartment on a high floor. A bed/couch, a chair or two, and a saxophone sits on a stand. Bernard walks in first, followed by Adeline, and then Marc, who carries all the bags, struggling. Bernard takes in his struggle and smiles.
Là-bas.
Marc stops, stares at Bernard, understands, and sets the luggage on the bed.
Non, toi, là-bas. Tu dois là-bas.
Bernard points to Marc, trying to let him know that Marc will be sleeping there.
C'est bon, Bernard. C'est
quoi?
Bernard sits.
My guess is that he wants me to sleep here.
Don't worry about him. He likes...
Me, sure. Can I get cleaned up somewhere?
La toilette. Elle est où? Over there.
Dis-lui qu'on son 23 jours un spectacle ce soir. Ça me dérange. Jules doit venir avec nous, mais...
Ouais, c'est bon. Marc?
Yes?
We are going out soon, if you would like.
Sure. Oh, what's this?
It's a...
saxophone.
Is it yours? Do you play?
Il dit quoi?
Yes, my brother plays in the band. Jazz band.
Comme Sid Caesar et Bobby Watson, fresh. Good the music.
Cool.
Oui, cool. Mets-toi pas du tout cool.
He said that...
It's okay, I get it.
Marc walks towards the bathroom.
Je l'aime pas.
Je me fous.
Adeline, elle t'aime pas. Elle est strange. Je sais pas, je la trouve curieuse.
Il m'aime, Bernard. Et je l'aimais. S'il te plaît, donne-lui une chance.
Adeline walks up to her brother and hugs him.
Il n'a besoin que tu fasses quoi, tu fasses le mien.
Bof. Il est tellement con.
Adeline hits him on the shoulder.
Con. My mignon quand même.
Moments later, at the bathroom, Marc enters and takes off his shirt and runs the faucet. He cleans himself, eventually noticing a window. As he looks out the window at Montmartre, we are suddenly looking at Van Gogh's painting of Rooftops in Paris, 1886. Van Gogh appears in the mirror.
What do you want? I told you to stop and leave me alone.
You realize you brought us to a diseased city filled with bourgeois materialism and spiritual corruption. This town will destroy you. Destroy us.
You are destroying me. You're not real. You're a voice in my head trying to...
Trying to remind you of your destiny. Trying to remind you of your true adventure.
I choose to be here. I choose this adventure.
You're not an adventurer by choice, but by fate. This is the wrong adventure, Marc. You are fighting the inevitable and wasting valuable time. We should be alone. Alone. At work. Creating art.
I am creating art. I'm creating experiences. I'm creating the gallery of memories that I need in order to appreciate and understand art.
By what? Falling in love? You don't truly love her.
I do love her. And only her.
You are not only failing me, but failing God, then. There is life after this life that God will give to those that love him with all their heart. It cannot be wasted on a fleeting feeling.
A fleeting feeling? You're pathetic. You don't think I know?
Know what?
You act as if I don't know who you are, who you were. I know. You think I don't, but I know.
Know what?
Have you ever loved?
I love my art, my devotion.
No, have you ever loved a woman?
No.
Yes, you have a lot, and none of them, none loved you.
That isn't why I warn you.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not. Love brings difficulties, Marc. It takes you away from what you should be doing. You replace your devotion to your craft by devoting yourself to someone. That in itself is to split your heart. Your heart is the center of your love. To split this is to make you half an artist. To love your art is to love God. To love God is to love he who has blessed you. That is the only love that you need.
Please, just leave me alone. Stop being here.
Van Gogh steps out of the mirror.
Marc, I know that I have perhaps been aggressive with you, but please believe me when I tell you again that we are linked. I cannot leave you and I cannot allow you to waste time. We have a purpose. We have a fate.
I don't want this fate, Vincent. I do not intend to spare myself. Spare the chance to live, not to avoid emotions or difficulties. I don't care much whether I live a long or short life. I just want to live a life that's mine. I don't owe you or anyone anything.
Marc, you do. The world concerns you because deep down you feel a certain debt towards it. And it is important that you realize that you need to leave souvenirs for them to remember you by.
I don't want to be remembered. I just want to be. Just want to be.
All right. All right. You want to live? Live. You want to be? Be. Be whoever you want to be, Marc, but don't forget who you are. You are me. And no city, no girl, nothing will help you get away from that.
Van Gogh disappears. Marc stares at the mirror for a moment, puts his shirt back on. Faintly, we hear a jazz song. Scene 3, later that night. Moulin de Galette, a bar. Bernard sits on a stool playing the saxophone. Adeline and Marc stand by the bar.
He's pretty good.
Yes, well, he thinks so. You've been pretty quiet since we left the lounge. Are you okay?
Yeah, just getting accustomed.
What is that?
Just getting used to everything. Everyone.
Don't be scared, Marc. I know it's difficult. Everyone's speaking a different language, different look to everyone, but they're all people, like you, like me, a little bit like Bernard. Well, maybe not so much like Bernard.
You're wonderful.
I know. But so are you. You want to dance, maybe?
Oh, no, I...
Please.
Adeline takes Mark's hand. They walk to center. The music changes to something appropriate. They dance closely, passionately. In this next section, filled with offstage voices, Marc looks around at us from time to time, breaking his focus from Adeline. At the bar, a man enters and ends up at the bar with his back to the audience. He leans.
The best way for him to know God is to love and appreciate many things.
Mom?
Marc?
Sorry.
An odyssey that will be peppered with triumph and tragedy.
What's happening?
Nothing. It's okay.
What else do you like? Marc!
I just need a break.
I don't understand.
I'm so sorry, Marc. You need help.
Marc!
Just give me a break! Adeline, I need a moment. I'll be right back.
Marc leaves Adeline alone at center and crosses away, still searching in the crowd. Adeline watches him leave upset. She walks back to the bar, standing next to the man. Bernard continues to play. I'm not a slave to anything, even if you think I am.
Who said that?
It's just the beginning, Marc. I know your destiny. This is just the beginning.
Where are you? Stop this.
I'm not doing this, Marc. You are.
You're doing this. I know you are.
No, this is your mind. Your mind is doing this.
Why is it?
I don't know.
Of course you do. What is happening to me?
Your conscience. Paintings have a life of their own that derive from the painter's soul. You are denying your soul of what it really wants.
I know what I want. I want Adeline. That's what I want.
I realize that now, but what your heart desires does not feed what your soul, our soul, starves.
No. This is another one of your tricks. Enough. Enough. I just want to be me. I am not you. I am not...
During the preceding exchange, Adeline and the man at the bar are quietly chatting. Eventually, the man makes an advance on Adeline and kisses her. She fights him, but the man continues his advances. On Marc's last line, he turns to see this, and with rage brewing from his exchange with Van Gogh, he rushes the bar. He grabs the man and starts pummeling him. Bernard stops playing his saxophone and rushes to the bar to break up the fight. Adeline tries to stop Marc, but he pushes her off in his rage, throwing her to the ground. Bernard ends up lifting her up before ripping Marc off the man, When the man is revealed, we see Van Gogh.
I am not you! I am not a painter! I am not Van Gogh! I am not you! I am not Van Gogh! I am not you! I am not Van Gogh!
Marc, stop this!
Arrête, Marc! C'est ce que c'est, Marc!
Bernard eventually rips Marc off the man, who lays motionless. Bernard checks on the man, who eventually starts moving, trying to get to his knees.
Allons-y. Adeline, allez.
Adeline in tears gives a long look at Marc as she exits. Bernard grabs his sacks and grabs Marc, who gives one last look at the man trying to get up. They exit. The man, Van Gogh, rises and looks at their exit, then looks at us. Scene 4. Later that night. Pont d'Arts. Adeline walks ahead of Marc and Bernard, who are in a drunken hug. Bernard has his saxophone strapped on him. He holds a bottle of booze, sharing it with Marc from time to time.
Trop bon, man. Super cool. Wow. Ta continue de la frapper lance des les visages comme il théâtrien de tour. Trop fort.
What did he say, Adeline?
He said he likes you.
I like you too, man.
Te comme Rocky. Boom, boom, bam, boom.
Boom, boom, bam, boom.
They continue their drunken boxing match. Adeline stops letting them walk by.
Tu non laisses le colo que sur compte.
Pourquoi? Elle est géniale, ton mec.
Bernie, s'il te plaît.
D'accord. Salut, Rocky.
Salut, Bernard.
Bernard exits. Marc continues his shadow boxing. He stops seeing Adeline's look.
What was that?
What?
You know what, Marc. Is there something you're not telling me about you? Do you have a problem? Something wrong with you?
No.
Yes, you do. You're not telling me. It's the same thing as our first night together. Fine. I'll tell you something, Marc. I know that I am in love with you, but whoever that was, the man that you were when you were hitting that poor drunk man without stopping, I don't want that person. I want to know who I love, and I want to know who I love to know me. Until you can tell me what that was and what is going on with you, I don't want to hear you speak. What is it, Marc? What is it that you are running from all the way to France? What is it that you are trying to forget? Who are you trying to forget? I know you love me, but loving me and me loving you, that's not going to make what you are running, going through, go away. Love is not a cure. I can help, but I have to know. I want to be loved as I am, not because of what you expect me to do. Tell me, Marc, please let me know you.
Saxophone solo can be heard off.
Allez, Rocky.
Adeline exits. Marc watches her, bottle in hand.
You cannot tell her, Marc. I don't have a choice. I will tell her. Tomorrow.
Marc falls to his knees, surrounded by Paris. Sounds of a train can be heard off. Scene 5, the next day. The train to Arles. Adeline sits by a window, taking in the passing scenery. Marc enters and sits across her. She won't look at him. He tries thrice to get her attention. The ticket agent enters.
Be it.
Adeline hands the tickets to him without looking at him. The ticket agent takes in the mood, punches tickets, and leaves.
When I was 8 years old, my mom took me to a museum and I saw my first Van Gogh. As I looked at it, the painting, I saw slicing creases and colorful crusts and harassing hairs from beaten brushes, thick, abysmal dabs of paint. I saw so much so quickly, colors. Came to life. Life. I was in the painting, breathing, standing, and a voice guided me to this room, his bedroom in Arles. Then I met the voice. I saw the voice. Him. Vincent. He told me right away with such certainty and pride and love that I am him. My life, my destiny is to be the next Van Gogh. Since then, since that day, he's here. He's here, and he speaks, he appears, he pushes and tells and dictates. Every day I'm reminded that I'm supposed to be him. Van Gogh, Van Gogh. I know you think this is crazy. Of course you do. It is. But I live with him. I live with him and a destiny that he reminds me of, a destiny that may never happen, a destiny that scared me until I met you.
You, who I love, you who's here. So, when I fight, when I fought, it's because I can't lose you. Without you, he wins. Without you, I lose.
Why?
I love you for so many.
No. Why you?
She leaves her seat and leans on him. She lifts his head.
I don't know. But.
But what?
I am who I am because of him. My moods change, but the average is serenity. I'm learning to accept that I cannot change this. I have a firm faith in my art, a firm confidence in it being a powerful stream which can carry me. This faith comes from him. I think it's such a great blessing when a man has found his work, his calling, that I cannot count myself among the unfortunate. I mean, I may be in certain relatively great difficulties, and yes, there are many gloomy days in my life, but I shouldn't be counted among the unfortunate. It wouldn't be correct if I was.
You are not unfortunate.
And what am I?
You are you, because of you, not because of him. You don't need him. You only think you do. You just need me.
I can't leave him, and he won't leave me.
We will get you help then.
What if I don't want help? Will you leave me then? Adeline?
No, Marc. I will not leave you. I will only hope that you will realize that you can leave him.
I will try, Adeline. I promise you I will try.
Marc, what would life be if we had no courage to change anything?
She gets up and sits next to him, eventually laying on his lap.
Kiss me.
They kiss. He continues to caress her hair until she falls asleep. Marc stares out at the window. Day slowly turns to night. The outside screen turns into Van Gogh's painting of Starry Night in Rome, 1888. Van Gogh appears and sits across from Marc and the slumbering Adeline.
It's beautiful, isn't it? Paradise.
Yes.
Where are you going?
To her agent's house in the south. Arles, so she can finish her novel.
Good. That's good.
I'm sorry I failed you.
You haven't. I believe that it may happen that one will succeed, and one must not begin to despair. Even though defeated here and there, and even though one sometimes feels a kind of decay, though things are go differently from the expected, it is necessary to take heart again and new courage. For the great things are not done by impulse, but by a series of small things brought together. And great things are not something accidental, but must certainly be willed. What is drawing? How does one learn it? It is working through an invisible iron wall that seems to stand between what one feels and what one can do.
Why don't you want me to love her?
You were right, Marc. I hardly felt what it is like to love a woman, as you do. I just know the most important thing is not to deceive or desert a woman.
I won't do that to her.
That is what you believe, but your art may lead you to it.
I would never deceive or desert her.
Maybe. But in being so adamant about you never doing that to her, have you considered that she may one day do that to you?
She wouldn't.
Yes, yes, you're right. How would I know?
You wouldn't. You know nothing of love.
Maybe.
Van Gogh rises and exits. Marc looks down at Adeline. Eventually, he rises and leaves her on the bench. He walks to downstage center and scans the entire audience. He starts air painting our faces. Scene 6, a week later, a yellow house, a desk with typewriter and stack of papers, a chair to accompany it, an easel and paint supplies on opposite side. Adeline types, Marc paints. A theatrical time lapse as the two work at their crafts. From time to time they connect, happy. They continue their work, days, nights, weeks, until the typing stops.
Marc.
Where?
C'est fini.
Fini?
No, not c'est fini. C'est fini. It's finished.
Like, done? Done?
Yes. I mean, it will probably need some re-editing, but I've done a lot of them already. I need to call my agent to tell him, and then I want to go out. We've been stuck here for weeks now. We deserve to go celebrate.
Yes, of course. What does this mean, CN?
It's the name of my lead, my protagonist. It's her story.
It's a pretty name, like Adeline.
You are the sweetest thing. Now go get ready, Marc. I want to have a big B from having fun tonight.
She exits. Marc puts the first page back and stares at the manuscript. He walks over to his canvas and stares at it. His mood shifts. He pushes down the easel to the floor. On the screens, nothing until Van Gogh's Night Cafe, 1888. A terrace cafe. Two bottles of wine, one empty. Marc walks up to Adeline, already sitting down.
What's the matter?
Nothing.
Something.
So, what's next? For your book, I mean.
Well, my agent, because of the popularity of the poetry book I did, thinks it would be fun and exciting to have a party.
Party? I don't understand.
He wants me, us, to go to Cannes and to have a big party for the book launching. He wants to invite lots of important people and have them meet me and for us to celebrate the book.
When?
I don't know. A few months from now, once the book is fully edited and he has enough time to do promotion and print copies.
That's great.
You're great.
Adeline, I...
What is it, Mark? Aren't you happy for us? For me?
Of course I'm happy for you. I'm just feeling strange, that's all.
What kind of strange?
I'm just feeling selfish. Not sure what I'm gonna do. I can't seem to paint anything.
But you are trying, Mark. You are disciplined. You have perseverance. Eventually, something will happen.
I don't know.
Has he...
No, he hasn't been around.
That's good, isn't it?
Well, I guess, except at least when he's around, I paint something, even if it's not good.
Maybe you are still trying to let go of him. Maybe it's mourning, like a transition until you are free to be who you are. Maybe once you're free, fully free, then your brush will come back.
What if it doesn't?
It will.
How can you be so sure?
I just am. You've just fallen down right now, but you will go on with your drawing soon. You will rise again.
What did you say?
I said you fallen.
No, the last part.
You will rise again?
Are you talking to him? How did you know that?
What are you talking about?
How do you know to say that I shall rise again? Did he tell you this? Is that where he's been? Is he with you? Answer me!
Just when I thought you were past this vain stuff about Van Gogh, you can't even be happy for me for one moment. Genuinely happy. On a night like this, a night we should be finding beauty and love, you ruin it. You ruin us by acting crazy and criminal. I'm about to finally do what I promised myself and honor my wish for my poor dead father, and all you care about and think about is whether or not a figment of your imagination is talking to me. You hurt me, Marc. Don't hurt me, Marc. Find your own way home. Salo.
She leaves in a hurry.
What am I doing?
He gets up quickly and exits the same direction as her. Moments later, on the country road, above the town, Adeline walks alone, hurt and disappointed.
Adeline! Adeline, please wait!
She walks faster. Marc enters, running up to her and stopping her. As he does, the screen brings up Van Gogh's Starry Night, 1889.
I'm sorry. You're right, you're absolutely right. Sometimes he leaves an impression on me as though he's teaching me something, but truly, he's trying to decay me, to make me paranoid, and I see that right now. I see that if one keeps loving faithfully what is really worth loving and does not waste one's love on the crazy, on insignificant and unworthy things, one will get more light by and by and grow stronger. You strengthen me, Adeline. I'm just an idiot to forget that and to concentrate on what weakens me. Forgive me, please forgive me.
Salut.
I know that means bastard in French.
You are still one.
You're right. I'm a bastard. Salut. Salut, you hear me? I'm a salut. Bastard, bastard, salut.
Shh. You wake up people in town.
Salut.
Marc and Adeline listen to the cries from the town. They laugh until they kiss passionately, kneeling in each other's arms.
I'm so sorry, Adeline, I don't
I
want
love
to
you,
hurt.
Marc.
No,
just
I mean
be
it.
Quiet.
I love.
Oh, bon Dieu, je t'aime.
Je t'aime aussi.
They continue to kiss.
Let's continue this at home. Au revoir, ma chère. Soyez prête à fêter.
She sprints off.
Wait, what does that...
Oh, on your mind? Get there?
That is not fair.
Marc starts getting up. As he does, he, for the first time, takes in the beauty of the town on this starry night.
Wow.
Marc exits slowly as faint music is heard. Scene 7, a month or two later. A grand ballroom. The music gets louder. Adeline enters and dances at center. Occasionally, she nods and smiles to invisible guests. She shakes hands, gives cheek kisses. But mainly, she dances, alone, at center. Marc enters and tucks and watches her dance. Eventually, she notices his gaze and draws him in. They dance. Colors on the screens dancing as well. From opposite sides of the stage, Lex Reed, a curator, and Georgie Gunagoo enter in conversation. They don't notice at first the dance. Georgie sees Marc, immediately leaving his conversation with Lex.
Excuse me, senorita.
Georgie watches Marc dance, but also notices Adeline, who stares back at him. Marc does not notice their interaction.
Marc.
I'm getting better, Adeline. I've figured out some steps. If you notice, I'm only stepping on your feet every other beat.
No, look, Marc.
Georgie? Marc?
How are you?
They make to hug, but Marc hesitates and gives his hand.
Not acceptable.
Georgie hugs his best friend.
Georgie, I've thought about you often.
Oh, it's mutual, my friend. How are you?
I'm great. Things are great.
That's great.
Marc.
Just one second. What are you doing here?
Marc.
Honey, please. Adeline Signac, this is one of my old college... This is an old college friend of mine, Georgie Gunagoo.
Enchanté, Mademoiselle Signac.
Enchanté. You must be the bottom bunk.
Bottom what? Yes, we were roommates. Bottom bunk. Je comprends.
Vous le parfait. Vous parlez français?
Comment ça?
When did you learn French?
Same time I learned Italian.
Show off.
I know, isn't it great? God, I've missed seeing you, Marc.
Me too, Georgie. I'm really very...
No, not worth it, man. Leave all that alone. What matters is the present, and it must be a good present if we're running into each other in calm.
Yeah, thanks. Why are you here?
Well, that gentleman there is my boss, Senior Lex Reed. He's the curator of the Torino Art Gallery, and from my understanding, is in love with Miss Signac's poetry here.
Oh.
Thank you. I hope you will like the book.
I'm sure you will.
I'm going to get a drink, Marc. A pleasure to meet you, Monsieur Gunagoo.
Votre plaisir est le mien.
Merci, Monsieur Gunagoo. I will let you bunk brothers get reacquainted. D'accord?
D'accord. Too sweet.
Both men watch her leave.
Looks like I'm not the only one learning languages.
Since we've been together, I've tried to make an effort.
It's great. So you guys are together?
Yeah.
How long has it been?
Almost a year now.
That's great, Marc. You're looking good. Still painting?
Yeah, lots. I mean, she writes and I paint. We're both very busy with our stuff, you know?
Good. She's seen your paintings?
Of course she has. What about you? What have you been doing?
Oh, man. Senior Reed took me under his belt immediately. I'm his assistant curator now. We did a mini exhibit of my work a few months ago.
Marc, get this.
A woman threw herself, I mean threw herself, at one of my paintings. Thankfully, she didn't break it, but ever since then, I've had to put them in glass casings, you know? Funny stuff. And I'm sure you know.
Yeah.
Hey, wait a minute. Senior Reed has given me a 3-month exhibit at one of our sister galleries in Amsterdam. Why don't I get the two of you to meet and chat right now and see if it would be cool with you exhibiting one of your works?
One of mine?
Yeah. I mean, if you're painting as much as you say you are, we would love to showcase that. And I mean, you're with Adeline Signac.
It's actually Adeline, you say it like that.
Right. Signac. This could be big, man. Oh my God, we have to do this. It's destiny, Marc. Hang on.
Georgie walks away from Marc over to Lex Reed. They have a mini chat in the meantime. Adeline has returned with two drinks.
Here, Manavol.
Oh, thank you. You're the best.
Is everything okay?
Well, yes, actually. Georgie thinks his boss, the curator at the Torino Art Gallery...
Lex Reed?
Yes, do you know him?
Most artists and writers in Europe know of him.
Well, Georgie's got this big exhibit of his work in Amsterdam coming up, and he thinks that Lex Reed would maybe give me a chance to have one of my paintings there.
That is great!
Yeah, Signor Reed is also a big fan of you and your work.
Really?
Georgie and Lex Reed walk up to Adeline and Marc.
Marc André Hoop, Adeline Signac, it is my pleasure to introduce you to Signor Lex Reed.
Signora Signac, I'm a very big admirer of your literature. Look very forward to reading your novels, Ian.
Grazie, Signor.
Signor Hoop, Signor Gunnagoo speaks very highly of your art.
That's very nice of him.
It is a most unfortunate evening. I feel I meet writer I enjoy very much, and I meet, perhaps, future artist. That I would like very much.
Signor, maybe you and Marc can discuss what I proposed?
Si, very good.
Adeline, why don't we leave the Signor and Marc alone for a moment?
Très bien. Signor Reed, please do not steal Marc away from me for too long. He is a great artist, and much of my literary successes are because of his love of all art.
Mi dispiace. Signor Signac, I will do no such thing. Well, I can't promise this.
Enjoy your conversation. This is it, Marc.
Signor Hoop.
Marc, please.
Marc, what is your art to you in this life?
Devotion. Devotion is the art of life.
Sta bene. Si, what is devotion then?
Devotion is to realize that one must love, work, and dare if one really wants to live.
Very nice. What do you draw, Marc? What is the essence of your work?
I want to do drawings which touch people. In figure or landscape, I should wish to express not sentimental melancholy, but serious sorrow.
Molto bene. Why do you paint?
Why I paint? I feel a certain debt toward this world. Out of gratitude, I want to paint something that I can leave this world as a souvenir.
I see a great deal of Georgie in you, but knowing that you are friends, it is very possible that a great deal of you is in Georgie. Because of that, I offer you the following. I would like for you to paint something that expresses serious sorrow, dolore grave. Unfortunately, due to the timing of our meeting, I can only give you 2 weeks to make this happen. What do you think? Can this be a reality?
It already is.
Sta bene. I look forward to seeing your work.
The men shake hands. Georgie and Adeline, on opposite side of the stage, are taking in Marc and Lex's conversation from afar.
I hope that is a good sign.
It is.
Why are you so sure?
Well, they shook hands, and Signor Reed has aphophobia.
What is that?
The fear of touching people.
Oh, that is wonderful. Not that Signor Reed is apho... Just that. I hope Marc is happy.
Well, he must be.
Yes.
I actually meant that he must be because of you. Voilà, tu es belle.
Thank you. Merci. I'm also très mince.
Of course, I was just expressing the truth.
Bien sûr.
So, you've seen Marc's paintings?
Yes.
And you enjoy them?
Yes.
Really? I just asked because Marc hasn't always had the most positive and successful response to his work.
Then why do you support him? Why would you help him speak to Signor Reed? I know why.
Why?
Because you do believe in him. You believe he has something. Something deep down in his soul that will one day create something you never could.
Marc? Yeah.
You mock me?
No, of course
you do. I will tell you this. Marc loves many things, and therein lies true strength. And whoever loves much performs much and can accomplish much. And what is done in love is done well. Because he loves art, art will love him. We all will love him.
Adeline walks away from Georgie towards Marc and Reed. Georgie follows after a moment. Marc and Reed are in mid-laugh.
Am I interrupting? Mi dispiace, Signor Reed. but I wish to dance with mi amore.
Signora, no apology necessary. You have a good man here. I like him. Enjoy your dance. Marc, I look forward to...
Dolore grave, si, signor.
Learning Italiano, honey.
Così?
Così, così.
Grazie, così, così.
Georgie joins them and goes to Marc. Adeline goes to Lex Reed.
Thanks.
I didn't do anything.
Yes, you did, Georgie. Thank you.
Good luck. I'll drop in on you while you're working on the piece.
You were right about our future. I'm sorry I doubted you. You're a great friend, Georgie. A great friend.
Yeah. She's a great girl, Marc. Congrats. Signor Reed, lasciamo soli gli amanti.
See, we should leave the lovers alone. Arrivederci. Signor Hoop, signor, signet. Sei un artista meraviglioso.
Grazie, signor. Buona notte. Good night, Mr. Gonagoo.
Good night, signor. Bye, Georgie.
Bye, Marc. Till the next time, Adeline.
Georgie gives one last look at Adeline as he exits with Lex Reed. Marc notices the exchange but shrugs it off.
So?
No. First you, so is your agent happy?
I'm the buzz of Europe.
You mean the bee?
Yes, the bee of Europe. And you?
I've got 2 weeks to paint something that the world will finally see.
2 weeks?
Well, 13 days, I guess, since I plan on doing nothing but holding you tonight. Dance?
But my feet.
I will not step on them, see?
See.
They dance. As they do, Van Gogh's painting of the dance hall, 1888, appears on the screens. A small time lapse. Scene 8, a week later, a studio in Avea or Torino. Georgie Gonagu enters.
Marc? Marc? Adeline?
Georgie makes his way around the studio. He takes in all the different invisible paintings.
Oh, boy.
Bonjour, Georgie.
Bonjour, Adeline. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. And you?
Great. Where's Marc? I told him I would check in on him.
He's still asleep. He's been working hard.
Yeah, I can see that. Which one's mine? I mean, which one is he working on for Senior Reed?
I'm not sure. He doesn't let me in here often.
I mean, you realize that I'm taking a pretty big gamble on Marc here. He needs to make something that...
He will. I wish you wouldn't doubt that.
I don't doubt it. I just know that... Yes, you're right. I doubt it. Don't you?
No. I don't doubt him. He will do it. There has been a power in him, a power that will soon be freed.
I hope so, because if he doesn't, I can't help him anymore. You understand?
I understand. Society is full of that. People like you, who strive to make a show instead of leading a true existence.
Excuse me?
You wouldn't understand.
Why do you not like me?
I like you.
You do?
Yes, but I love him.
For now. Is there something that I've done to make you feel that you cannot trust me?
No.
Then why do you not trust me?
Because someone who asked that question cannot be trusted.
I don't understand.
Try understanding the way you look at me.
I look at you the way you should be looked at. Don't you like it?
I don't like it.
You hesitate. You do like it.
No, I do not.
Are you sure?
Hey, Georgie!
Hey, Marc. Thought I would drop by and see how things are going. I know this deadline is pretty rough, but I really hope things are going well.
Yeah, it's going well. I will have something ready.
Great. Well, can you take a break? I'd love to take you downtown, Torino, au revoir. There's a great art fair by the Umberto Bridge, a sort of Marche des Pitons. Are you down?
No. I've got work to do. Maybe after this painting is done.
Of course. Of course. What about you, Adeline? Would you like to join me?
No. I've got work to do.
All right. No worries. Just thought you guys could take a break. I know Mark's got work to do. Must be difficult to work, Marc, alone when you have such a beautiful woman to keep you company.
She inspires me.
Of course. She must be very inspiring. It's like a factory of paintings in here.
Why don't you go with him, honey? You might find some inspiration for your next book.
It's okay. I have plenty of inspiration here.
You sure? I mean, I can be a good guide to inspiration.
Yeah, Georgie's a good friend. He can inspire.
Okay, if you really think so, do you?
Oui, Sherry. I could use the time away from you to try to finish this painting.
Which one is the one you're working on?
It's a surprise. It's in a different room.
Well, you're always full of surprises, Marc.
You too, Georgie.
All right, well, Adeline, I'll meet you outside.
Sure.
Get to work, Marc. Can't wait, man.
He exits.
Why are you doing this? I don't like him very much. I don't trust him.
I trust you. He's a good guy. He's inspiring.
You are inspiring.
She hugs him. He pulls away.
What now?
I don't know. I'm scared. I haven't painted anything yet. I can't seem to find the inspiration. I can't find anything.
It will come to you. I know it.
When?
I don't know.
She tries to kiss him. He stops her.
I just need some time alone.
Alone? Or away?
He approaches her and kisses her.
Just alone.
Then I will go. I know. I will bring you some sunflowers. Those are your favorite.
That sounds good.
Ma.
Adeline.
Je t'aime.
I love you too.
They kiss. She exits. He watches her go. He walks up to his easel and stares at it. He grabs a paintbrush and some paint. He dabs the paintbrush and lifts his arm. His hand shakes. He tries to put in brush to canvas, but his hand shakes so much, he drops the brush.
Oh, come on, concentrate. Don't think. Just paint. Just paint.
He tries the process again, but fails. Again. He throws his brush on the floor and grabs a painter's knife and cuts through the canvases. The cuts happen on the screens. Black crows appear on the screens. They fly and fly until the screens turn to Van Gogh's Crows in a Wheat Field, 1890. Van Gogh appears.
Pain.
What?
Pain. That's what it is. That's what's waiting for you.
What do you mean?
The woman you love. Love itself is about to be destroyed, and you let it. Because deep down, you knew that it's the only way for you to feel what you need to feel in order to feel to paint. To paint what you feel.
Adeline?
Of course. She's about to desert you. She's about to deceive you.
No.
Go find out. Go find out for yourself. You will see. This was always the destiny. And you let it. You gave her permission because you knew.
No, you're lying. She would never.
There is no never in life. That is its beauty. Everything is possible. She begged you not to let her. You allowed her to go and be entranced by him. I warned you about him. I warned you about her.
You're wrong. She would never do that.
But what if he would? Would I be wrong then?
He would never.
Never? Never. Never. The more you repeat the word, do you not hear it becoming a heartbeat? Never. Never. Never.
Stop.
Never, never, never!
Stop!
Everything is possible, no matter how triumphant or tragic it may be.
Marc rushes out, painter's knife in hand. Van Gogh disappears. Scene 9, a little while later. The Umberto Bridge. A sunny day. Georgie and Adeline, who carry sunflowers, walk together. Georgie stops her, grabbing his ankle.
Ah, wait.
What's the matter?
Nothing, just my foot's hurting. Didn't exactly wear the right shoes. Just need a second. You don't mind.
That's fine.
Those are beautiful flowers you bought. Sunflowers.
They're for Marc. They're his favorite.
You love him, don't you?
Yes, very much.
Do you mind if I ask why? Don't take it the wrong way. I just want to know what it is about him that you love. It's okay, never mind.
His kiss. When he kisses me, I feel his soul, the pulse, his heart. He kisses me like I'm the most important thing in the world. He kisses me every time, like it might be the last time. My father, when he was sick, he would kiss me on the forehead, and like Marc, every time he kissed me, I could feel his life. There was pain, fear, but also joy, love. I'm a better writer now than I ever was before, and I can describe many beautiful things so others can know what my stories, characters feel. But I could never, never describe truly how Marc kisses me and the feelings, the emotions I feel when he does.
Marc enters, painter's knife in hand, opposite side of the bridge. He watches from afar.
I would rather die than to never kiss Marc again.
Georgie, entranced by her, leans in and kisses her aggressively. They freeze.
No. No.
Marc rushes out, dropping his painter's knife. They unfreeze as he does. She turns and slaps Georgie with the sunflowers in her hand, hitting him a number of times.
You bastard!
She rushes out, leaving Georgie alone.
I'm sorry, Adeline. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to... Damn it!
He picks up the sunflowers and chases after her. He notices the knife as he chases her.
Marc?
Scene 10, a little while later. Marc enters his studio possessed. Immediately, he walks up to his easel and finds brush, paint. He faces upstage. The screens come to life. He begins to paint, pain. On the screens, we see his painting come to life and with every stroke. Van Gogh appears. Marc notices him, but continues to paint.
I'm sorry, Marc.
You knew.
I've tried. I've tried to warn you, but this was always your destiny.
You destroyed love for me.
Marc continues to paint, a beautiful array of lines and colors.
No, Marc. Love is eternal. The aspect may change, but not the essence. There is the same difference in a person before and after he is in love, and there is in an unlighted lamp and one that is burning. The lamp was there and was a good lamp, but now it is shedding light too. And that is its real function. And love makes one calmer about many things, and that way one is more fit for one's work. Our future is bright, Marc. This is the beginning of your dynasty and of our destiny.
Marc is possessed, painting quickly, but with every stroke creating a masterpiece. Adeline arrives, but is locked out of the studio.
Marc, let me in, Marc. I have to tell you something.
Marc stops painting for a moment, contemplates, but continues.
Marc, let me in.
Don't listen to her, Marc. Keep going. This is it. Feel the feathered brushes. Breathe the paint.
Marc, please. Why won't you open the door? Answer me, Marc. Please.
She exits hurriedly.
You're almost done, Marc. Soon the world will see. They will finally see what you and I have known all this time.
Marc finishes the painting. Marc-Andre Hoop's The Kiss at the Umberto Bridge, 2012. It is the exact replica of what the kiss he saw between Adeline and Georgie, done in the style of Van Gogh. It is breathtaking.
I'm so very proud of you, Marc. We have risen again, and our future is set. You are me, and I am you, and for the rest of your life, the world will know of our art.
No.
Marc walks around the studio gathering paint tubes and buckets.
What do you mean, no? Look at our work, Marc. It's beautiful.
My work, Vincent. My work. This is the first and the last one ever.
What do you mean?
Marc starts opening the paint tubes and buckets. He starts to swallow the paint, spilling it all over himself.
Stop! What are you doing, Marc? Don't do this!
I am you, and you are me.
Not like this, Marc, please. You don't need to do this.
Marc continues drinking the paint, choking himself with the poison.
Please, Marc, this is not our destiny. This is not our fate.
I want to be able to die like this. I put my life and my soul into our work and have lost my heart in the process. She is my love, not you. Not painting. I don't want anything else, Vincent. I'm sorry, but this is it. For both of us. I thank you, my friend, my mentor, for trying to help me see the light, but I want none of it. I will never see again without Adeline. I wish you could understand that. I wish you would only take me as I am.
He drinks more. Van Gogh mirrors his weakening. The two kneel beside one another.
I do, Marc. I do. We will rise again.
No. We will not. Never.
They die. Adeline has returned with keys. She unlocks the door and rushes in and sees Marc on the floor, dead. She throws herself on his painted body.
Marc? No, Marc! No! Je t'aime. Ne me quitte pas. S'il te plaît, Marc. Don't leave me.
She embraces him, and while holding him upstage, she sees his painting. She realizes. She kneels. She keens and keens and keens. The lights fade on them. The screen comes to life with a masterful melange of Vincent van Gogh and Marc-Andre Hoop's work. The end.
lead right into a discussion with you about the play, what you've just experienced. If you need to use the restroom or you're leaving, and take a moment to do that. I'm going to ask the playwright if he'll come join us, Pasha. Well, I think I want to begin with what will sound like an extremely general question, but hopefully one that you may have right at your fingertips of your feelings, if so. What was the experience of this play like for you?
Loved it.
Loved it? Try to put into words, if you can, for the playwrights. We're here to kind of get response, and then we'll get more specific. But I just thought we'd begin, yes.
Well, I'm very familiar with most of the works you were describing, so I was visualizing everything as it was happening. In fact, I was sitting here with my eyes closed, part of it because I was seeing the painting. So you did an excellent job of triggering those images. So I thought it was great.
Other experiences. Yes.
It was fate, how something from the time he was a little boy, you had a feeling that his whole life and all his relationships were moving towards this final end.
And how did that make you feel?
Well, sort of inevitable, but that there was really nothing he could do to change him. And the other people cannot do anything.
And if you don't mind me taking that one step farther, and it's okay if you do, you'd say no, thank you. Then what does that make you feel, that fact? That was inevitable.
I can't.
Okay. No. I'm just seeing responses here. Others, the experience of the play. Yes.
It was interesting watching the play out of all these different emotions going through different bodies and how they came back and affected the young man who was the center of the plot. To watch, it's interesting to watch the externalization of all those emotions come back to him as opposed to them all being in him.
Hmm.
Does that make any sense?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, thank you. Yes.
I thought it was a lot of good versus evil with the Van Gogh. Almost as if he was trying to corrupt him, and he was trying to pull him out of the corruption, and the people around him were leading one side or the other.
So for you, Van Gogh was a kind of a force of evil.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And trying to corrupt. Yes.
I just like to second that. I found Van Gogh sinister, and although I don't know a lot about Van Gogh, this was a surprising take on Van Gogh, especially since the effect of a great artist isn't usually seen as sinister. So it had me puzzled.
May I ask to ask everyone to follow that up? How much of you brought what you knew about Van Gogh to that, and how many of you had things change because of how he's portrayed? Yes.
I knew that. Yes. I really felt extremely anxious during the number of scenes, and I really wanted him to fight. I wanted him to find his courage.
Okay. Thank you. Yes.
I didn't like Van Gogh being
Yeah, so that bothered you that Van Gogh was portrayed as sinister. Anyone else feel that? Yes.
Yeah. Well, Van Gogh was a very mentally disturbed artist, and he had a lot of torment between, things in his life, and he actually killed himself at the end. He shot himself.
Right. Yes.
This is just a point of curiosity. Since 2002, there seems to have been a resurgence of interest in Van Gogh in New York in 2004, mm-hmm. maybe? There mm-hmm. was a show put on by, was it Lincoln Center, about Vincent, his brother. Has there been a resurgence in Van Gogh in the whole artistic community? What's going on?
Well, We could talk about that at a later time. There has been in actuality, and we just had the fabulous Australian exhibit here called Van Gogh Live. That was quite the experience at the Science Museum. But there is also, there's been a lot of research about his mental illnesses. And we'll talk. And also about even the ear aspect that many doctors feel that he suffered from something that they couldn't have known then, mm-hmm. and that this caused. And so there's been some interesting attachments of new information of sorts to reevaluate who he was.
Have any of the
Yeah.
As far as being an activist.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, Van Gogh, sinister to me too. And to realize that Van Gogh was actually kicked out of a town, the citizens of the town petitioned the sheriff or somebody to literally boot him out of town. He was so nasty and mean.
Yeah.
So it kind of...
So you were okay with...
I was okay with that, because he was a sinister character probably in real life in many ways.
Yes.
I was, and I have to admit, I know next to nothing about Van Gogh, so I'll preface it with that. But the references to God with the father and the parents, and then Van Gogh's references to God, and it was just, I like that there wasn't a side to God, because often in theater, you know, either you know the people who believe in God are portrayed as crazies, or you know, there's just a tone with God, and but I was curious about the parents. Obviously, the father was very God oriented, and then Van Gogh made a lot of references to God, and I was just curious about that. And I liked that it was a neutral position.
Well, thank you for sharing that. Can I ask where you ended up in your feelings about the central character, Marc? As you now have seen the play and had even just a couple of minutes after it's over and heard it, what do you feel about this central character? What?
Sadness?
He's tormented.
He was tormented?
It takes a great deal of strength to stand here on your own two feet in any part of the artistic world.
Okay.
I think there was two things going on with him. One was his relationship issues with his mother and his first girlfriend, and then the second girlfriend. And his second one was his obsession with Van Gogh. I mean, he was obsessed with him. He fantasized him, he visualized him, he kept seeing him wherever he went. And I'm not sure if there was some issue about trying to seek his approval or trying to heal his relationship issues or something in there. That was at work.
Thanks for sharing that. I think I want to ask, do you feel like you know what that was in Marc that connected, that caused this? Because he's quite young, right, when this takes place. Do you feel like you have a sense of what took place there? Yes.
Well, I think clearly his father is disengaged from him, and his father clearly wasn't any type of mentor to him. I don't know if you know, that's where it comes from, but I had a suspicion. It was clear at the beginning that the father was, that it was a very mother-son relationship and the father was disengaged.
Okay. Did anyone feel that Marc was a victim?
Yes.
No. Yeah, I wondered if I'd hear different things. Say why no.
Because of his own actions.
Okay. So you felt there were choices.
Yes, and that's where I got very anxious and wanted him to step up to his courage.
Okay.
And even against his betrayal with George.
Good, yes. There and then behind, yes.
I really like the way that the playwright portrayed Marc, mostly because I felt he was very typical. I believe that this could be anybody in the world, and these are struggles that people go through, but it's all based on your experiences growing up. And what do you do
change them or make your life better. And I just feel like he crumbled in adversity instead of overcoming. So I just think that maturity did play a factor, and he just didn't grow in order to develop into his own self.
Thank you. In front there. How did you feel about the final scene in which he does finally paint? Yes, Bill.
It seemed abrupt, and yes, we've been leading to it, but it felt that that the actual betrayal in that case was his friend, who he'd been separated from for years, but who had also betrayed him earlier. So that in essence, it feels as though the episode of happening to be on a bridge when he tries to take advantage of his love, and she's not at fault, felt to me like I was getting manipulated, that in a certain way, that final floodgate that opens, leading immediately to the decision to end it all, did ultimately feel melodramatic.
Okay. Yes.
I was disappointed when he swallowed the